You know, someday, I don't know, I don't think, I didn't in all the masses, but in one, actually I did, just different forms, different extents. But I felt the leading of the Holy Spirit and wanting me to speak about preparing. Because I really believe God has something great in store for us as head.
Amen.
One of you believe, believes me.
Amen.
That makes two. Okay. Prepare. I saw this picture on the internet. A man on the street with a big placard. You know how that some prophets would have placards saying, "Repent, or prepare, the end is near." This guy had something, a placard too, but what was written on it was, "Prepare, the beginning is near." The beginning is near. I want us to prepare because the beginning of something great is near. Ask the person beside you, do you believe him?
You believe him?
Yes, sir.
Beginning of birth pangs, which is good. The beginning, you anticipate birth. Birth is a beginning. It's not the end. It's a beginning of something good. And we wait in joyful expectation for that which is not the end, but the beginning. Beginning of something good. I want us to understand that one major way Jesus prescribes for preparing is very, very simple. He simply said, occupy till I come. Occupy till I come. Just continue to work. Continue to work. By the way, rest is not equivalent to no work. Rest, let me repeat that. Rest does not mean no work. Not in the sense of rest that God wants us to have. Rest is found in peaceful work of service to God. Remember what Jesus said, Matthew chapter 11, Matthew 11, 28. Come to me, all of you who are, what? Heavy laden. All of you who are tired and heavy laden. Yung mga napapagal, sabi nga sa Tagalog, no? And I will give you what?
Rest.
How does He give you rest? He gives you a burden. Right? He gives you a yoke. What is a yoke for?
Pang trabaho. Pang araro.
Right? So, the rest that He gives to us is not necessarily we're going to do nothing. No, the rest He gives us is the same rest He gave Adam. What rest did He give Adam when Adam was living his eternal life in paradise? Before sin, before death, before the curse. What rest was that? Cultivate and keep. That was the rest that was given. In Jesus Christ's work, in His burden, in His yoke, we find rest. Adam wasn't out one taman, you know. He worked, but he worked in peace. In fact, he didn't sweat until after the fall. Sweat was a sign of the curse. And what does that represent? Anxiety in work. The difference between a peaceful man and an anxious man is not work, but is lack of peace in work. The sweat is anxiety, it's a lack of peace. In the Old Testament, there was a rule for altar ministers, particularly, especially for the priest. They were not to sweat at the altar. Not to sweat. It doesn't have anything to do with temperature. Because sweat was a sign of anxiety. And in the presence of the Lord, they should not be anxiety displayed or demonstrated or shown. In the presence of the Lord, there's fullness of joy, there's fullness of peace. So there's no sweat. That's also why they were given headbands that read right on the forehead, holiness unto the Lord, meaning delivered from the curse of this, which sweat represents. Remember the curse that God inflicted on Adam? He said, by the sweat of your brow, you will work and you will till the land. You ever also heard the saying, the wicked have no rest, and the righteous don't need it? The wicked have no rest because they have no peace. The righteous don't need rest in that they don't need stoppage from work. If you want rest, do the right work, the work of God, that which is done in peace. Now also, as we work in the service of God, I want also to emphasize something, that we don't always expect the spectacular. We don't always, success is not measured only by in leaps and bounds, but in small increments, in small things, done faithfully, consistently, routinely, every day. Every day. You know, and as children of God, we must banish from our mentality the what I would call the jackpot mentality, the get-rich-quick mentality. No, we work. We prove ourselves faithful in small things so that God would increase us. We have time in the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is eternal. I'm not saying, you know, what I'm saying is just do little things every day. That's why we have daily office every day. You know, sometimes, like last night's Bible study, in the case of the youth, sometimes there's, you know, exuberant joy. Sometimes there's emotions involved. Sometimes you feel the presence of God more intense than at other meetings, right? Sometimes you don't feel like coming to daily office or coming to Bible study or whatever. But those things are not wasted. Those things add to the growth process and to the prospering. Not always spectacular. Remember when Jesus, it was just the gospel at daily office, morning, and the judgment, when Jesus gathered everyone, and then he said, it said, he gathered those on the right as sheep, those on the left as like goats, the righteous and the wicked. And he told the righteous, come enter into the kingdom of my Father, prepared for you from before the foundation of the world. Because you did this and you did that, when you did it to the least of my brethren, you did it to me. What did the righteous say? Huh? We did it to you? Don't even remember. It was just part of our everyday routine. Small things. Not wasted. No, I just went with our community when we ministered in this poor area. We the youth just went to Pedilia and ministered to those who were in need. You don't even remember. You know? Jesus said, I do. Those little things, they count. And what you did to the least of my brethren, no fanfare, probably nobody even knew, probably didn't even make it to a Facebook post. You know? No epal, no nothing, no headlines. God sees in secret. And little things. Now, what I'm not saying just give a little. No, our little is always our all. But sometimes, you know, we don't see drum rolls and all that fanfare. But those things are not wasted because God sees. The prayers of the people, they accumulate, the prayers of the saints and the martyrs, they accumulate into a big incense bowl, and that eventually, that all goes up to the heavenlies, and God knows that. You know, and I'm not tooting my own horn, okay, but somebody told me, well, somebody consistently tells me, an American, okay, whenever they see me, they say, man, you're so tough. They don't see my waistline, so I said, what? Because in my mind, what I do is just keep a regular routine. I don't work out like, you know, Arnold Schwarzenegger. Just do a little at a time, but consistently. Kayo may mga Facebook account, kayo mga nag-internet. How many times have you seen something like, she drank lemon water daily for so many days, and watch what happens, right? Invites you to click that whatever, right? Or she mixed lemon with honey and then consumed it every day for like 28 days, 30 days. Watch what happens. Begin, so you have to click it and open the page. But see that, right? A little a day, but consistent. In fact, you know, it's better, you would understand it's better to have a what they call a training split. Instead of working out every time your full body, what you do is one day you exercise your, say, shoulders and back, and then another day your legs, the other day your arms, etc. It's better to do that three times or four times a week than one intense full body workout once a week. Consistent, faithful and consistent. This servant that Jesus said, you know, who is then is the faithful, wise and faithful servant who feeds his master's household every day, gives them their food every day. He is the one whom his master finds so doing when he returns. And when he rewards him, what will he say? I do something big. I just fed the pets every day. And not just the pets, of course, but the whole household. I just did that every day. Just being faithful to my to the small things that were given to me. You know, I showed you, it was our last day at ECU, right? When I showed you the title in the name of Cathedral of the King, right? What is that a product of? That is after 37 years. What's that the product of? 25 years of praying the corporate petition. Sometimes you were into it, sometimes you mumbled it while you were thinking of dinner, or did I turn off the TV when I left the house? Little by little, 25 years. Also the product of land offerings. As far as I know, Father Beth, correct me, correct me if I'm wrong. As far as I know, I don't recall anyone giving 1,000,000 pesos in land offering at one time. But the small, consistent giving of our all, of what we could afford at a time, gave us a result. And this is just the beginning. Prepare, the beginning is near. Beginning is near. Also the product of 8 years. It's been 8 years now. 8 years of giving land offerings. Do it to the least of my brothers, you do it unto me. Like I said, no fanfare. And we don't always look for the spectacular. In a building of a physical edifice, sometimes you don't feel or you don't see growth. There's seemingly no progress. Because sometimes, you know, they would put a hollow block on top of another and they would put cement inside the hollow block. That cement adds to the growth. You don't even see it, right? And kung ang ginawa lang nila, kunwari, itong araw na to, no? They only filled the holes in the hollow blocks. You would observe nothing happened to it, right? And then you see, I don't know, big windows or big doors installed. Now there's progress. No, there's progress all along. Every single step is important and part of the progress. God sees in secret. Success is not measured by just the spurts, the leaps and bounds, but even the small increments. You know, there's no such thing as low mass or high mass. At every mass, Jesus is present. Every time a priest prays the prayer of consecration, Jesus comes down to overpower the elements and makes them become his body and his blood. And I've said this before, I quoted the patriarch Adler, who said before, there's a lot more things accomplished in 1 hour of Mass toward the restoration of the earth than a whole day in Congress. Just 1 hour at Mass. Little things. Sometimes you don't even feel alive, right? I mean, you go to Mass. It was an obligation. Priest was so sleepy. You know, I slept through his homily. But it accomplished much more than senators and congressmen could do in one day toward the restoration of all things. Be it a Mass at a big cathedral with 10,000, whatever, 5,000 attendees, a big church, 10,000 attendees, or just small gathering of two or three, which Jesus said he will be there if they gather in his name. Those small gatherings accomplish much. In fact, even just the prayer of one righteous man accomplishes much. No matter what he's going through, even if he doesn't feel like praying, it accomplishes much. I encourage you, don't lose the rest, don't lose the peace in an anxiety that your work was wasted or did not contribute to the prospering of things. Sometimes you think, oh, this doesn't add anything to the growth of our church or to the growth of our nation or whatever. No. Do not lose the rest and the peace in that anxiety. Sunday, I sensed in my spirit some were on the verge of just giving up. Some were thinking, is it worth it? Are we going somewhere? Are we moving? Are we just gaining ground? And we, sometimes we doubt. Is God still with us? Will he provide for us? Will he do this? Will he do that? And I said, well, it's darkest right before dawn. And then I encouraged us to lift our heads because I can just feel it. I can just sense it in my spirit that God is preparing to do something great. And I'm not just prophesying. I really believe this. I really feel this. Because we have been faithful. If we feel we haven't been, time is now. Just consistently, just do whatever we are tasked to do, no matter what, how small or how small we think it is. Just consistently do it. Consistently. James 5:7-8 says, be patient until the coming of the Lord. The farmer patiently waits for the precious produce of the soil, until it gets the early and late rains. Be patient and occupy until God comes. Just feed. Just do what you're supposed to do every day. Just every day. Pray for your children. Parents, pray for your children every day. Just do it every day. Just be consistent about it. The staff, sometimes you probably drag yourself to daily office because it's too early. Just consistently do it. Because one day, you will see results. One day, you will see results. Remember this parable of, it's called the parable of the seed. In fact, I want to read it, just so I don't miss what I would like to say. It's found in, if you have your Bibles, open it to Mark chapter 4. It's found there, it's two verses, 45 and 46. No, sorry, 26 and 29. And Jesus was saying, "The kingdom of God is like a man who casts seed upon the soil. What does he do after casting seed upon the soil? He has peace. Going to bed at night, and then he gets up by day. He's not anxious thinking, uy, tutubo kaya itong tinanim ko? Tama kaya yung pagtanim ko? No. As long as he did it faithfully, with all his might, and serving God, he plants seed, sows seed on the soil, he goes to bed at night in peace. And then the seed sprouts and grows. How? He himself does not know, because it's not his part. It's God's part. The multiplying is God's part. Our task is just be faithful to cast seed. God will take care of the multiplication. The soil produces crops by itself. First the blade, then the head, and the mature grain. Then, when the crop permits, he immediately puts in the sickle because the harvest has come. You know, when I remember this 20 years ago, at my wedding, somebody told me, right at my wedding, this is the time to relax. This guy was married. Then, I already got married. I have got married then. He said, relax, this is time to relax. It's not time to be anxious. You've been anxious and working, maybe, for the past, I don't know, 3-6 months. You cannot do anything anyway at this point. What you need to do is enjoy the fruit of what you have done the past several months. Because if you're anxious now, you just wasted what you built up to this day. What you need to do is relax and leave it all up to God. By the way, that's the essence of the Sabbath. That's simply the meaning of Sabbath. You work 6 days, you let God, you go to bed at night, you let God do his task of multiplying what you have worked for. An archdeacon in the church at, it's called St. Michael's in California, the former headquarters of the CEC, where Patriarch Adler was the bishop of, or rector of. The archdeacon then, you remember him, Father Dan Sharp, he would tell us, okay, prepare this and that, say for a big event, he was here for the consecration, first consecration, said, do this, observe that, remember this, train yourself to do this and that. And then whenever the day comes for the big event, he would say, forget everything I told you. Not forget, like, don't observe it, but just drop everything, drop every anxiety. Just be led by the Spirit and be at peace. Because what you have prepared for should be in you now, should be in your DNA now, should guide you now, and you should flow naturally now. If you should be in peace. But the more you are anxious, the more you will be affected. Be at peace now. You've done your preparation. In the Old Testament, God would command the Israelites, right? Gather manna for 6 days. Gather for the first 5 days, gather for what's good for 1 day. Because if you gather more, what happened? It would go bad, right? It would spoil. And they could not eat it. And they would not just, they could not eat it, it would stink. It would fill their house with bad odor. Some did, Moses, which, you know, or Moses and God. But on the sixth day, they were commanded to do what? Gather for 2 days. And miraculously, every week, miraculously, on the Sabbath day, where they were not allowed to gather, they had provision. Manna that did not go bad, just for that special day. Because God was doing His work. After they have done their work for a week. Again, let me emphasize, rest is found in peaceful work. It's not found in doing nothing. In fact, doing nothing will make you bored. Right? Rest is found in peaceful work in the service of God. How? By the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. I want to quote now this one guy named Ignatius of Laodicea. This is what he said about the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, God is far away. And Christ stays in the past. The gospel is a dead letter. The church is simply an organization. And authority is simply a matter of domination. Mission is just a matter of propaganda. And liturgy is just nostalgia. Christian living is simply slave morality. But with the Holy Spirit, God is with us. The universe is resurrected and groans with the birth pangs of God's kingdom. With the Holy Spirit, the risen Christ is here. The gospel is a living force. The church is a communion in the life of the Trinity, the body of the living Christ. And authority is a service that liberates people. Mission becomes Pentecost. Liturgy is a memorial and an anticipation. And human action is God's work in the world. In other words, the Holy Spirit gives life to anything and everything we do, small or great. Except by the Holy Spirit, no one can say Jesus is Lord, St. Paul said in Corinthians. On that last day at TCU also, I reminded us that we are CEC, Charismatic Episcopal Church, charismatic, sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Which is, I'm afraid, in some cases, has been a dormant characteristic of our church. And we need to revive it. I can remember, this was not in Manila. I think we were in Laguna. Again, Patriarch Adler. You know Patriarch Adler, right? He was a prophet. He was very sensitive to the Spirit. He was crying one time. And he was saying, do not ever let go of the Holy Spirit. He was sensing he told us, you are fast becoming Roman Catholics. Remember who you are. You're charismatic, you're evangelical, you're sacramental. But you're not just sacramental. You're still, and will always be, sensitive, or should be sensitive to the Spirit. Because without the Holy Spirit, you're just dead. Without the Holy Spirit, you just go round and round. Without the Holy Spirit, what you do has no meaning. Without the Holy Spirit, there is no life. We proclaim Jesus as Lord by the Holy Spirit. In fact, we do all things for the glory of God by the Holy Spirit. Because as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the children of God. So I encourage you, I can't say this enough. Do not stop doing the things that glorify God. The things that you have been given as your task. Even if they're small or great, even if you get the attention of people, even if you get praises or not, the small and the great, they all are part of building up to birth pangs, of building up to, of coming together to a result, to something great God has in store for us. Which again, I say again, will just be the beginning. Do not stop. Everything sown, including those sown in tears, will one day be reaped in joy. One day. Like I said, we will shortly see the reaping come. Soon. Prepare because the beginning is near. Because with the Holy Spirit, we can do all things. And through Him, we do all things. And those things don't go to waste. Those things add up to the growth, to the progress, and to the glory of God. With the Holy Spirit, we are able to love God with our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and our neighbor as ourselves. Small things. I encourage you. When the service officially ends, we have fellowship. We share some snack. Do even just small things. Just how are you doing, right? A pat on the shoulder. Maybe somebody's going through a problem. Maybe somebody's going through a crisis. Maybe what you think is small is something great for that someone, right? I can remember this more than 20 years ago. One routine Friday evening service at Magallanes Bien. Somebody was going to commit suicide. Why he attended church then, I don't know, right? But he came to the Friday evening service with a gun on his person. God with him. And he was planning to commit suicide after the service. Somebody had a word of knowledge and said, whoever you are, don't do it. But you were, he didn't know he was going to commit suicide. He just said, you're planning to do something, don't do it, because your life is precious in God's sight, and He loves you. He's a plan for you. That guy is a clergyman. Now, the guy that was supposed to kill himself. He's a clergyman now, serving in our church. Not one of you, not in the CEC. Okay? Don't go looking for COVID suicide then. Maybe, yung mga kausap niyo mamaya, kung ano man yung hawak nila, pandesal o pansin. Maybe they're planning to commit suicide. Who knows, right? And you're there, assigned by God to stop them. Just by saying, kumusta ka na? God loves you. Peace be with you. Whatever. Right? Huwag lang pautak naman. Baka lalo mag-suicide yan. It's just, you know, small things. To us, small. Sometimes it's just routine. The father of Father Obed was an usher. Just distributing flyers and announcement sheets, greeting everyone, probably didn't even know what he did to normal life. A young widow at that time, going through a hard time, going through a tough day so far. And then he just greeted her, and suddenly made a big difference in her life from that day forward. One small routine task in ministry. Was it small? No, it wasn't. It was something great. And here I have to say, do not judge what you do. Just do it faithfully and consistently, because they all built up to something great. And God sees every bit of what we do. We do it faithfully, we do it consistently, and in the name and to the glory of God. The joy of our Master is just the beginning of more and exciting, fulfilling things. Work, yes, maybe work. That's what God wants us to experience. And when we experience that, when we see that, work will not be a burden. We will see it as a joy, a fulfillment, a privilege, an honor. And we would be thankfully doing it, not dragging ourselves and forcing ourselves and trying to bring ourselves up to do it. Because this is what God wants us to experience. This is what God wants us to experience. His joy. Because this is the way it is in His kingdom. I want us all to stand.